Okay, so we have seen how the theory of linear vector spaces of with finite dimensions is basically the same as the theory of matrices, right? And so in this spirit, we have been looking at a number of results of matrices, and we'll continue along this direction. In this lecture, we will collect together a bunch of useful results pertaining to eigenvalues and eigenvectors of matrices. Okay, so it's very common to find matrices which have only real numbers, right? So if you have only real numbers in matrices, you know, if you have matrices with only real numbers, it brings in some constraints for the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So let's work this out. So if you have a real matrix, each eigenvalue is necessarily either complex, is either real, or if it is complex, then its complex conjugate is also an eigenvalue, right? So complex eigenvalues appear in pairs, conjugate pairs, right? So this is a consequence of, you know, the, okay, let's work out the argument for this. So that matrix A is real, so all its elements are real. So we start with the eigenvalue equation. A acting on X is lambda times X. So we have the characteristic equation is just determinant of A minus lambda I equal to zero, which we know is an nth degree polynomial equation of the form summation over I bm bm times lambda to the m. So this should be actually, it will go all the way from zero. Right. So m equal to, so if m equal to zero, that's the constant, right? You can have a constant term, then you have, you know, a linear term, a quadratic term, so on, all the way up to n, right? So so the point is that all these coefficients are real. That's the key point, right? And whenever you have a polynomial equation of this kind, let's say that lambda is the root of this equation, then it means that, you know, this equation holds, and then we have the freedom to take the complex conjugate of this entire equation. And then since BMs are all real, so they remain unchanged. And so wherever you have lambda, you will have to replace it with lambda star. So which means that, you know, the same equation holds. So let me correct this. So this is M going all the way from 0 to N. In place of lambda, I have lambda star, right? Hence, either lambda is real or its complex conjugate 2 is. So it means that either lambda equal to lambda star or lambda star, which is distinct from lambda, is also a root, right? So the corollary of the above result is that if you have a real matrix of odd dimension, then at least it has to have one real eigenvalue, right? Because if you have an odd number, you cannot have only pairs of complex, you know, complex numbers in their conjugates. There will be at least one which doesn't have a pair, and that eigenvalue must be real. Okay, so the next result is that if you have a real matrix, then, you know, and if it has a real eigenvalue, then the eigenvector corresponding to this real eigenvalue can be chosen to be real, right? That's the first result. I mean, of this second result, the part A of this result. And then the other you know, result which we wish to show is if you have a real matrix, that means all the elements are real, and if you have it has, you know, an eigenvalue lambda 1 which is complex, then, and it who's with an eigenvector x1, then we can show that the eigenvector corresponding to lambda 1 star, which is also an eigenvalue, right, which we have already argued, the complex conjugate of x1 is going to be the eigenvector corresponding to lambda 1 star, right? Again, this is something that we can show from the first principle. So you have ax is equal to lambda x. So let's say that, you know, we take, so there is a real eigenvalue lambda corresponding to which there is an eigenvector x, right? At this point, we're not saying that x is real or complex, but let's say it is complex in general. You have managed to find one eigenvector, then you can of course write this complex vector as, you know, real part of this plus I times imaginary part, right? You have two vectors, xr and xi. The real part of x will, you know, all the real parts of these components will go into xr, and the complex, the imaginary part will go into xi. Both xr and xi are real vectors, right? So now you will show that in fact both xr and xi themselves are eigenvectors with the same eigenvalue, right? So the argument is very straightforward. So you just see that a times, in place of x you put this in, so you see that axr is equal plus I times axi is equal to lambda xr plus plus I times lambda xi. Now you just compare coefficients on compare the real part and the imaginary part on both sides. So since a is real, xr is real, a times xr better be real, and a is real, xi is real, so a times xi is real. So that means in fact axi is the imaginary part on the left hand side, and again lambda xr is real, lambda xi is real, so I times lambda xi is, you know, lambda xi is the imaginary part of the right hand side. So comparing the real and imaginary parts, we immediately have axr is equal to lambda xr and axi is equal to lambda xi. Therefore both xr and xi are real eigenvectors corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda. Of course xr and xi don't have to be distinct, right? They could be basically the same, or, you know, the product of, if there's a constant factor or something like that, they can be there. Two of them can be, you know, trivially connected, or they may be independent also, right? Depends on the situation, right? So the point is that if you have are able to find one eigenvector for a real eigenvalue, there is a way to just take the real part or take the imaginary part of this vector, and you have a, you know, real eigenvector corresponding to a real eigenvalue. And so the other result is, you know, if ax1 is equal to lambda 1 x1, and lambda 1 is a complex eigenvalue, so if a is real and if x1 also were real, then the left hand side would be real, whereas the right hand side is complex, which is untenable. Therefore you know, x1 has to be complex, and then you just take a complex conjugate of this entire equation, both sides. So complex conjugate of a will do nothing to it, so it will be just left as a, but x1 will become x1 star, lambda 1 will become lambda 1 star x1 star. But this is explicitly just the eigenvalue equation, you know, saying that the matrix A has x1 star as an eigenvector with eigenvalue lambda 1 star, which is the result we were trying to prove. Okay, the next result is eigenvalues of a real symmetric matrix are all real, and eigenvectors of a real symmetric matrix can be chosen to be real, right? These are two results, you know, two parts of the same result. But I mean, we have already seen that Hermitian operators in general, right, have real eigenvalues. We proved this in greater generality, right? Where the way we did it was, you know, to look at what a Hermitian operator does to some arbitrary ket vector, and then we took the dual space vector of this, and then used the hermeticity property, and then managed to show, you know, compute the same matrix element in two different ways, and then argued that it, you know, this forces that all eigenvalues of Hermitian matrices to be, Hermitian operators to be real, and therefore, and a real symmetric matrix is a special type of a Hermitian operator, right, where all the elements are also real. Symmetric property of, you know, this real matrix is where the hermeticity comes in, and so therefore it also follows that its eigenvalues must be real, right? You can also, you know, laboriously go over the same type of procedure, you know, take the dual space vector and so on and directly prove it, but we have already proved this in more greater generality. So indeed, real symmetric matrices have real eigenvalues, you know, and the other result is also something that we have just proved, right? We have said that whenever you have a real matrix with real eigenvalues, you can always find a way to get real eigenvectors. And so since for a real symmetric matrix all eigenvalues are real, there is a way to find real eigenvectors corresponding to them, right? So this is also something which follows from our earlier discussion. And the final result we want to discuss in this lecture is that eigenvalues of an anti-Hermitian matrix are purely imaginary. An anti-Hermitian matrix is, you know, is a matrix such that I times this matrix is Hermitian, right? So another way of defining this is A dagger is equal to minus A, right? So since IA is Hermitian, it's if I look at IA, right, we have just shown that the eigenvalue equation for IA will necessarily give you real eigenvalues. So if IA x is equal to lambda x, where lambda is necessarily real, I can pull this I to the right hand side, and then I have minus I on the right hand side, so I have AX is equal to minus I lambda X. So this again is an eigenvalue equation for the matrix A, right, which is Hermitian. So this suggests that, and with eigenvalue minus I lambda, where lambda is real, right, which means that every eigenvalue of a Hermitian, anti-Hermitian operator, A is anti-Hermitian, whereas IA is Hermitian, right? So we started with the assumption that A is anti-Hermitian, so IA is Hermitian. So we have managed to show that the eigenvalue equation for the anti-Hermitian operator A, you know, leads to purely imaginary eigenvalues, right? So this is something which is a direct consequence of the definition of an anti-Hermitian matrix and the properties of Hermitian matrices. Okay, so that's all for this lecture. We will look at more results pertaining to matrices in the lectures ahead. Thank you.